call on you because we need you. We can't get along without you. We need you every step of the way. Father, we pray that you would look and have mercy on our country today. You know all about our circumstances, but we are depending on you. We thank you for the power of prayer. We believe today, and so we receive. Father, we pray that you would just look and have mercy on those that are traveling to and from. And we pray, God, that you would save to the uttermost. Some of us still need to be saved according to the scriptures. And we pray that you would continue to watch over us as we go throughout even this day. And as we lift up this praise, this celebration today, we pray that you would forgive us of all of our sinfulness and cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness, and we shall be clean. We'll be so careful and mindful to give your name the praise, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' name we always pray. Amen.
This next song says, hallelujah, hallelujah. It says, Lord, we love you. It says, Lord, we praise you. It's a real simple praise and worship song that we'll lift together. As you catch it, we'd love it if you lift it with us. It's a song where we can just give God the highest praise, to be thankful for what he's done, to be thankful for what he's doing, to be thankful for what he knows he's going to do for us in the future. It's a real simple song that simply says, hallelujah. And we can sing together. Hallelujah. It's real simple. Hallelujah. It says hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's a real simple song. We'll say that again. Hallelujah. Let's give him the highest praise. Hallelujah. Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's just do that again as a whole church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We can say that together. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It says hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And the next part says, Lord, we love you. Say, Lord, we love you. We can say that together. Lord, we love you. Say, Lord, we love you. We'll stay right there again. Say, Lord, we love you. Let's lift that as a whole church this morning. Say, Lord. Love. Say, Lord, we love you. Say, Lord, we love you. And the next part says, Lord, we praise you. Say, let's put our hands together all over the room. We praise you. For what you've done for us, we praise you. Say, Lord, we praise you. If we've got some praisers in the room, you can lift that. Say, Lord, we praise. Say, Lord, we praise you. Say, Lord, we praise you. We praise you. will say it together. Hallelujah, say. Let's lift that all over the room. Say hallelujah. You all can lift that with us. Say hallelujah. Those that are grateful, you can say that with us. Hallelujah. All over the room this morning, we'll say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Because we're thankful for what you're doing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And now we're going to switch it up and we'll say, "Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let." If you know that, you can lift that with us all over the room. If you come to pour out your adoration on him, you can say that with us. Say, "Oh, come, let us adore him." Somebody say, "Christ the Lord." And why do we want to come adore him? It's because he's worthy. We can say, "For he alone. For he alone." If you know you serve a worthy God, you can lift that with us. Say, "For he alone is worthy. For he alone is worthy." Yeah. Somebody say, "He's worthy." "For he alone, you're a worthy God. For he alone, you're worthy, you're worthy, you're worthy." Say, "Christ the Lord." We can say that together all over the room. Say, "Christ the Lord." Yes, he is. "You're worthy, you're worthy. We adore you, we adore you." Yeah. One more time all over the room. Say, "Christ. Christ the Lord." This is the last time we'll say it together. Christ the Lord.
Come on, church, clap your hands today. He is worthy. If you have a praise in you, just let it come out. I don't need to make it come out. I don't want to force it out. But open up your own vent and give God the glory, the honor, and the praise. I don't know what you feel today, but I feel that he is worthy to be praised. And if you feel that he is worthy, you ought to praise him. We don't know how much time we have. But what we do know, we have right now. What we can deal with is right now. We can praise God right now, this morning, right where you are. No matter what you're going through, you can lift up the praise right now. Somebody still want to sing it. Come on, church, help us sing it today. It's in the praise. Whatever you need from God, it's in the praise. Christ the Lord. I promise you'll feel better. Clap your hands, church. God is with us. He will never leave us nor forsake us. We praise God for the young people bringing us this far. Make an investment in the praise and worship. You might leave and say, I didn't get anything out of the service. Well, I would ask you, what did you put in it? Those of you that are able to stand on your feet today, oh, how I love Jesus.
How I love you. Amen. Because he first loved us more than we loved ourselves. Amen. Our scripture reading for this morning is from the book of Isaiah, the 6th chapter and the 3rd verse. Revelations 19th chapter, verses 5 through 7, and the 34th number of Psalms, verse 3 and 8. Let us read together. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. Praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, small and great. Hallelujah. For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exalt and give him the glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in him. Amen. May God continue to add his richest blessings to the readers, to the hearers, and most certainly to the doers of his word.
Thank you. God, we thank you for walking with us. God, we thank you for talking with us. God, we thank you for letting us know that we are yours. God, we pray now that as we stand before this sacred desk, something is said that would change someone's heart. Lord God, we don't take this time for granted. But God, we pray that this time is handled in such a way that it blesses the people of God. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength, my redeemer. Let us all say amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, if you would, go with me to the New Testament writing of Romans. We'll get back to Matthew, because as you all know, we're now pressing into Matthew 10. I want to take a quick detour. I want to go to Romans 13th chapter. Romans 13, and we'll read verses 11 through 13a. Thank you for standing for in reverence of the reading of the Word of God, those of you who are able. You find words in this manner. And do this, understanding the present time. The hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. It seems like he was at a place where he is positioning the saints to endure a transition in time. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. And let us behave decently as in the daytime. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. As I read that text, brothers and sisters, one of the things that struck me as we use as a theme and a framework for this text, we want to use this subject. It's daylight praising time. It's daylight praising time. Brothers and sisters, I'm sure as it reflects our attendance, we know that many people dread to see daylight savings time approaching. Many people dislike this time because it is a change, and brothers and sisters, that causes one to lose an hour of sleep from the next day's schedule. Is there anybody in here lost an hour of sleep? This means that this morning many of us had to readjust. Many of us had to recalibrate. Many of us had to reconfigure our sleep pattern in order that we accommodate a change in our time schedule. For instance, this means for many of us that we had to let go of the bed an hour earlier. We had to turn loose the comfort and coziness of our cribs 60 minutes earlier in order to be on time. For many of us, especially those of us with little babies, this can be a colossal undertaking when you lose an hour of preparatory time. 1 hour, 60 minutes, 3,600 seconds, however you would like to frame it, or however you like to put it this morning, we had to reset our time. But my brothers and sisters, one thing about the biblical text is that you always find something in the biblical text that is relevant for our walk today. And what blesses me is that David helps spring us forward into daylight praising time when he so unashamedly and unapologetically declares that I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. So before we attempt to exegete the text of Romans this morning, David urges and encourages us, brothers and sisters, to play a game of praise and adoration. And as believers, brothers and sisters, in this Lent season, we ought to get used to lifting the name of God. We ought to get used to praising the name of Jesus. We ought to get used to adoring God for who he is and what God has done. That's why the text says, "Oh, magnify the Lord with me. And let us exalt and exalt his name together." And I just pray that pleasant parishioners today will get to the place, point, and position in your spiritual lives that you can help me praise God in a way of worship. And although many of us loathe the idea of losing an hour of sleep because of this infamous daylight savings time, there are theological implications of the springtime change which permeates throughout the biblical text. So if you would follow me, we'll get to those and we can leave. First of all, brothers and sisters, through a discerning eye, daylight saving time indicates new beginnings. Y'all saying, "Well, Reverend, I want you to show me that in the text." Thank you for saying that. Let's walk to the text. In this particular text, Paul is addressing the Gentile church in Rome. He's addressing the church in his particular community, and he's addressing the church kind of like I'm addressing this church in Lewis Place community. In chapter 13, Paul is in the midst of his exhortation of the Gentile church, and exhortation simply means a message of warning, a message of precautionary means, a memo of encouragement, and it was designed to motivate people to action. And I suggest to you, brothers and sisters, sometimes we need motivation. We need motivation in this life of fear-mongering, understanding that God has not given us the spirit of fear. We need, brothers and sisters, an encouraging word, knowing that we live in a world where we can't do so much. We need to hear an encouraging word that tells us that I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Brothers and sisters, we need an encouraging word. But brothers and sisters, sometimes we won't act unless we are motivated to do so. So here we see the Apostle Paul exhorting our fellow believers to live out our callings as true vicars of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He's calling us as believers to live as those who love God. He's calling us as believers to walk like we know Christ. He's calling us to give like we live generously. Brothers and sisters, he's calling us as believers in Matthew 10 to give generously because we have received generously. Brothers and sisters, he's calling us to walk out our faith in our deeds. Apostle Paul is exhorting fellow believers, brothers and sisters. So here we see the Apostle Paul giving the church a spiritual nudge in the right direction. And I want you to understand that sometimes, brothers and sisters, we need a spiritual nudge in the right direction. We see the Apostle Paul, he's giving that church that nudge. And the first thing that Paul exhorts us to do is, number one, wake up. Wake up. Paul is telling the church to wake up because it's nothing like a church that is a sleepy church. It's nothing like a church that is sleeping on the battlefield, because we all understand that hymn that says that we are on the battlefield. I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. I'm on the battlefield, and I promise him that I'd serve him till I die. Y'all know that hymn, don't you? I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. But brothers and sisters, one of the things about the battlefield, it's so dangerous till you can't go to sleep on the battlefield. A battlefield is somewhere where you got to be woke. It's a battlefield. I'm going to preach myself happy in this place today. In other words, brothers and sisters, you got to be woke. You've got to be conscientious. You've got to be cognitive of what is going on around you, because we are in no playground. We are on the battlefield. As a matter of fact, brothers and sisters, we are in such a dangerous place that the Word of God shares with us that we are in predatory land. Says we are in predatory land, so much so that the devil is seeking to whom he may devour. Brothers and sisters, we've got to stay woke on the battlefield. Saying stay woke. Stay woke. Dream woke. Brothers and sisters, you've got to get to a place where you are waking up. And what it means to wake up, brothers and sisters, it means that we are conscientious of what is going on around us. And for many of us, God has been trying to wake us up a long time. God has been trying to wake us up through the alarming episodes and the upsetting experiences that has happened in our lives. Someone may have had a loved one to die. That perhaps means that the Lord is trying to wake you up. Some of us perhaps have had a terrible experience. Perhaps it was an automobile accident. Perhaps that was the Lord trying to wake you up. God was trying to get our attention. He's trying to wake us up. If you don't believe me, brothers and sisters, I want you to understand that through the experiences of life, God tries to wake us up. You don't believe me? Let's call upon the witnesses of the church. God woke Jonah up when he got his attention after God put him on a 3-day timeout in the belly of a whale. Brothers and sisters, sometimes God tries to get our attention. You all remember what happened in Paul's life, don't you? God got his attention because God opened Paul's eyes by binding him with a light so brilliant that knocked him down on the Damascus Road. God is trying to get your attention. So Paul pleads with us to please wake up, my brothers and sisters, because the night of life is already spent and God has something for you to do in the ministry of not only the church, but God has something for you to do in the ministry of your life. God has something for you to do. So you got to wake up from the place where you are now and start walking and preaching and playing and praying for God to do something in your life. God has a way of waking us up. In other words, brothers and sisters, in life, we've got to get to the place and the point in our Christian walk where we can wake up and come out of the rain. There's many of us still in the rain. And brothers and sisters, we want you to come in out of the rain. And many of us don't come in out of the rain because we're comfortable. But I remember the old preacher used to say, he says, I know the text says, remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh. And he used to say, some of us don't do the things we used to do because we ain't even able to do it. But God wants you to come away from doing the things that you used to do simply because you trust him and you follow Christ. He wants us, number one, to wake up. So you ought to nudge your neighbor. Somebody might be physically asleep. I see some faces in here that's got their eyes closed and they sleeping. I ain't gonna call you out. They right up in church sleeping. But we want you to not only be woke physically, but we want you to be woke spiritually. Wake up. Next piece, brothers and sisters. To wake up means to change from night to day. That's what the text says, means to change one's life. And once you've gotten up, brothers and sisters, what the text says, we've got to clean up. Wake up, then we've got to clean up. My brothers and sisters, cleaning up indicates some level of preparedness of the believer. And we all know that with regards to daylight savings time, we've had to make some preparations to be ready for the time change. And I want you to understand that the church needs to wake up even in this context today, that we have been sleeping in such a position, brothers and sisters, but the church has changed in such a way that we need to wake up and see what is going on even in this 21st century age. Wake up, got to clean up. We've had, again, to make some preparations to get ready for a time change. Tell your neighbor again, wake up, clean up. In order to be on time, we've even had to reset our clocks, because if we don't reset our clocks, we will find ourselves abiding in an obsolete schedule. I see something right there. Sometimes you got to reset your clock. Because if you don't reset your clock, you'll find yourself abiding in an old schedule. A schedule that's no longer relevant. You've got to understand what ministry means today. And I want to challenge Pleasant Green to wake up and to understand what ministry or what it needs to do ministry. And brothers and sisters, sometimes we've got to understand that those who are unchurched don't need the same things that they need that they needed 20 years ago. Wish I had some help here. Even in the church, we've got to reset our clocks, because if we don't reset our clocks, ministry will be old. Ministries will be or use antiquated strategies for a contemporary time. If we don't reset our clocks, brothers and sisters, we can get to a place where we're using typewriter tools for an iPad generation. If we don't reset our clocks, we will be preaching Captain Kangaroo message to a JoJo Siwa generation. We'll have 8-track plans for a streaming period. If we are not careful to reset our clocks every now and then, we would offer a hopscotch recreation for a PlayStation 4 era. Songwriter says, I want to be ready. And being ready, my brothers and sisters, means not only preparing oneself for Christ's return, but it also means ensuring that the church is prepared to reach the least and the lost right now in the 21st century. Is this making any sense? It means resetting our clocks. And brothers and sisters, it's important to be able to reset our clocks to ensure that we are using effective tools for ministry to seek the spiritually misled, the spiritually misplaced, and confused, because Jesus said, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. So let's ask ourselves the question, what if? What if Noah had not moved with fear and expectation, and prepared an ark to deliver his house from the great flood? What if Noah had not moved in a place? See, everybody was talking about how Noah was a fool for building an ark on dry land. What that means in our context, we ought to build with intention that people would join. What I'm saying, I'm not just talking outside my head. What I mean is building a nursery with very intricate maybe this is for a meeting. But brothers and sisters, what I mean is thinking forward so that someone else can be impacted by what we do. Resetting our clocks. If Noah had not reset his clock, his family would have perished with the rest of the wicked generation of his day. What if Joseph had not reset his clock, laid up in store the grain that fed and sustained not only Egypt but Israel as well? Sons of Jacob, through which Christ would be born, would have died on the outskirts of the promised land if he had not reset his clock. And the heathen would have taken their place in Canaan. Brothers and sisters, I'm almost out of here, but in cleaning up, the text suggests to us that we are to cast off darkness. Let us put on the armor of light. Here, the scripture places attention on nightwear. My brothers and sisters, we all know that there are some things that customarily we only wear at night, right? Bring your mind back this way. Sometimes we wear old, dingy t-shirts to bed. Sometimes we wear discolored, tatted, worn fleece pajamas to bed. Brothers and sisters, what that suggests is those particular pieces of garments are only worn for the house and in the bed. And we tend to wear these things at night when there is no one watching us. The same holds true with the deeds that people normally do in the darkness of night that indicate in Scripture the evil deeds of man. Night in the text represents evil deeds. Some things that people do at night are like those old dirty pajamas we hope and we pray that no one sees. And they do them because they feel like no one is watching under the guise of night. And I'm sure you all have heard that old Johnny Taylor song, "The Nighttime is the Right Time." But my brothers and sisters, when you clean up, you take off all of those old garments. I wish I had some help in here. When you clean up, brothers and sisters, you pull off the stuff that you had on at night. You pull off all of those dirty garments. As a matter of fact, Ephesians 5 and 27 says that Jesus is coming back to a glorious church, not having spot nor wrinkle. Brothers and sisters, when we prepare ourselves for the coming of the Lord, we want to be acceptable in the sight of God. Says no spot or no blemish. We don't want to be messy. We don't want to be a hating church. We don't want to be ratchet. We don't want to be gossipers, but we want to be a church that spreads the gospel. The last thing that this text gives us, after we wake up, most of us, what we do, we clean up, right? After we wake up, we clean up, wash our face. I hope you do that. We wake up, we clean up, and then, brothers and sisters, we grow up. I pray that each day gives you an opportunity for growth. Each day gives you an opportunity to be better than you were before. You got to grow up. Y'all, I'm almost done. My brothers and sisters, growth requires that you get the right kind of nourishment in your daily diet. Daylight saving time symbolizes new beginnings. So we are in the midst of Lent. What I challenge you is to get the right kind of nourishment in your daily beginnings. The Bible indicates that there's something about light that inclines believers to love it. As I watch my plants grow, I call myself having a green thumb. I've discovered that when I put a plant in a windowsill, it reaches for the sun. And I pray that we as believers reach for the truth like a plant reaches for the sun. It reaches for the sun. It reaches for the light. And brothers and sisters, as believers, it's something about light. And if you don't believe me, Scripture says this with us. When Jesus said in John 8:12, he says, "I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have light, the light of life." And I also want you to be careful, because whatever you've done in the darkness will eventually come to light, because Jesus said in Luke 12:3, "Whatsoever you have spoken in darkness shall be heard in the light." Peter also has something to say about light. He says that you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a particular people, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of the darkness into the marvelous light. Brothers and sisters, what I'm sharing with you today is that you as a believer ought to reach toward the light, because when you reach toward the light, God will shine on you. God will give you growth. God will give you speed. God will give you strength. God will give you encouragement. God will give you what you need for a new day. God will help you to grow in an environment where it seems like ain't nobody growing. God will cause you not only to survive, but God will cause you to thrive. Brothers and sisters, you ought to wake up. You ought to clean up. You ought to grow up. I pray that this season does something for each of us here. I pray that this season causes us to wake up. I pray that this season causes us to clean up. And I pray that this season causes us to grow up. Amen. The door of the church is open. Hallelujah. Let's give God some praise. Come on. Come on. Let's give God some praise. We want to give God some praise. And as we give God some praise, brothers and sisters, let's not only worship God with our voice, but we also want to worship God with our gifts. Amen. Amen. The word of God says that God loveth a cheerful giver. We want to understand also, as those who are stewards over what God has given us, brothers and sisters, none of this that we own is ours. The word of God shares with us that God has asked for a tenth of what we own. In other words, if you have 10 apples, God doesn't want but one apple back. And that's called being good steward over what God has given us. Let's pray. God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you have done. And God, we pray that we understand what it means to be good stewards. God, help us to understand that the offering is a seed that we sow, and the tithe is what we owe. In Jesus' name we pray, thank God. And God, we pray that we are cheerful givers today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's give God some praise for who God is and what God has done. Has God been good to anybody in this place today? If God has been good, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we want to recognize all of our guests today. If you are a guest of Pleasant Green Missionary Baptist Church, we ask that you would stand. If you are a guest today of Pleasant Green Missionary Baptist Church, we ask that you stand. Amen. If you are a guest today, amen, 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 amen. We perhaps see that no one has stood as guests. But if there are any guests here today that perhaps did not want to stand, this is what we want to say to you, that we are a church who is continually striving to be a church that is pleasantly purposeful for all people. With that being said, we want to welcome them by saying, as a church whole, come on, say it with me, Pleasant Green, you are welcome. Amen, amen, amen. We are blessed by your presence. We are blessed by your presence. And brothers and sisters, we just have a couple of announcements. We pray that if you are available on Wednesday nights, that you would be a part of our Bible study. We ask that you come and share with us, because there is explanation of the word being rendered on Wednesday nights. Also, we want to look forward to our Holy Week. Lent ends and climaxes on Holy Week, right? Our Lent season climaxes on Holy Week. So on Holy Week, brothers and sisters, we will have a holy revival, the Hallelujah Holy Week, amen? We want to have our Hallelujah Holy Week just like on last year. With that being said, on April the 8th, on Holy Wednesday, we will have Anthony Riley of the Central Baptist Church to come and share with us in word on April the 8th on Holy Wednesday. Amen?
Amen.
On Maundy Thursday, we will have Reverend Brandon Blake of the New Sunny Mount Missionary Baptist Church. He'll be sharing with us on Thursday. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And also on Good Friday, we have a fish fry, and we want you to be here and be present. If you like fish, come and celebrate with our Pleasant parishioners, and it would be from 4 to 8:30. Amen. We bless God for this experience. And brothers and sisters, Pastor Letcher also will be speaking at Central Baptist Church at 12 o'clock noon on Good Friday. Before the fish fry, before you get the fish in your system, before you get the food, you can get the word. Amen. And Pastor Letcher will be speaking over at Central Baptist Church as one of the participants of the seven last sayings of Jesus Christ. That will start at 12 noon. Amen. At this point, we want to carve out time and space for a special announcement. Amen. A special announcement. If there is a special announcement. There is a special announcement. There is not a special announcement. Oh, amen.
Good afternoon, church family. This announcement is for the women. Sorry, men. This announcement is for the women. We are having a prayer breakfast, a prayer brunch, April 25th. And some of you may have the flyer. If not, will the committee please stand? These lovely ladies will be so happy to assist you in any information that you want to know about the prayer breakfast. We want you to come. We have other ladies that are not of this fold who will be attending as well. But some of you remember in the past our retreats and our prayer breakfast, and you know that we've had some dynamic speakers, and this one is just as good. So we're asking that the ladies will come out and share with us in this prayer brunch. We're going to feed you physically and spiritually. Thank you so much.
Brothers and sisters, we pray again that this Lent season has blessed you and that you have found something that you can give up in an effort to allow Jesus to come and dwell with you. That being said, brothers and sisters, we've had a great worship service. Let us stand on our feet.
Church, say amen. spoken, let the church say amen.
God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your power. And God, we thank you for your provision. God, now we ask that your Holy Spirit fall fresh upon us today. Keep us from the coronavirus. Keep us from the flu virus. But if we happen to get it, God, help us to press through and recover quickly.
Yes, Lord.
God, we thank you for each pleasant parishioner who is here today. And God, we pray that their life is enriched by being connected to Pleasant Green. God, we ask now that you look in on them, smile on them, embrace them in the mighty name of Jesus. Now unto him who's able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of God's glory with exceedingly joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. May we all say, amen. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, I love you.
I love you.
You can't do nothing about it.